Jim Ross, along with the legendary Bruno Sammartino. Two great hours for you, ladies and gentlemen. Bruno, we're going to start it off with a tremendous matchup. The athletes have already been introduced. Jake the Snake Roberts, one-on-one with Dustin Rhodes. But again, sir, thank you for being with us.
Jim, I'm thrilled to be here, and we got some great, great action coming up, and I can't wait.
It's going to be a great program, fans. Two big hours for you. Let's go up to our ring and our first event. Jake Roberts with that collar and elbow tie up, forcing Dustin Rhodes back into the corner. Two of the top stars in WCW kicking off this outstanding broadcast of WCW Saturday night. Side headlock by Rhodes. Good agility there. Avoiding Roberts. Headlock takeover. Good move by young Dustin Rhodes. Caught him with that forearm and drives Jake the Snake back into the corner. Also in this hour, ladies and gentlemen, you are going to see Hacksaw Butch Reed and the Barbarian take on Ron Simmons and Barry Windham. And before we went on the air today, a near tragic situation occurred involving Ron Simmons and Cactus Jack. We'll show you that a little bit later in the program. That occurred right before we went on the air. Bruno, this young Dustin Rhodes got a big score to settle here with Jake the Snake Roberts several weeks ago in Atlanta's Omni. Jake the Snake really did a number on young Dustin. And so this kid from Austin, Texas, the son of Dusty Rhodes, has revenge on his mind.
Well, this boy, Dustin, he may be young, but I'll tell you what, he's had a great coach. And, you know, watching him wrestle, he's a very, very talented young man. And I think that he's going to give Jake Roberts quite a battle.
Jake Roberts, the innovator of the DDT, the man that will meet Sting and spin the wheel, make the deal. On Halloween Havoc on Sunday night, October 25th. Dustin Rhodes frees himself from that wrist lock. Jake Roberts has a vast experience advantage here, Bruno.
Yes, he does, but that's where Dustin Rhodes has to be careful. I know he's excited, he's angry because of what happened, but he can't be over-aggressive because a guy like Roberts, if you make one mistake, that could mean a defeat because he's got that kind of a sharpness in the ring.
Rhodes with the wrist lock and the advantage. Jake the Snake tried a right. Dustin Rhodes got his right hand in. Young Dustin, who has been in tag team competition with Barry Windham very successfully in the last few weeks, has nothing but Jake Roberts on his mind right here. And again, he got the right hand in.
So far, he's doing great. He's hanging onto that arm, and he's really working it and weakening it. Every once in a while, Roberts gets up and tries to throw a right, but Dustin is quick. He ducks it, and he connects on his own with a right.
Rhodes,
hanging onto that arm, Jim.
He certainly is. With that hammerlock, and both men back up to a vertical base. Counter move there by Jake the Snake, but Rhodes got the elbow in and goes back to the arm. Great strategy for this young man.
Great strategy, because if he can stay on that arm, and as he is doing, and if he can really, really weaken that arm, then he's got the advantage, because I'll tell you, I don't care how good you are, if you're eliminating the use of that left arm, it's gonna put Jake in a very bad predicament.
Fans still to come in this hour, the unified World Tag Team Champions, Dr. Death Steve Williams and Terry Bam Bam Gordy. Shane Douglas will be here. We'll have more on Halloween Havoc with another Halloween Havoc Control Center. Brad Armstrong goes one-on-one with Beautiful Bobby. And much, much more still to come in this big two-hour broadcast as Dustin Rhodes continues a very sound, a very methodical strategy, working on the arm of Jake the Snake Roberts.
He's hanging on, he has to keep him. Now let's see, the Snake is gonna throw him through the ropes. Oh, beautiful. Now, you know, for the experience that Jake Roberts has, he telegraphed that when he whipped Dustin to the ropes, he bent a little too quick, and Dustin was really quick because he's got a lot of speed. He was real quick and he came up with that kick. Down he goes and back to the arm, very good.
Jake obviously in a great deal of pain here as Dustin Rhodes continues to put pressure on the arm. Jake slithers out of bounds here and the hold has been broken. And Roberts' arm is really being tested here.
If Dustin stays on that arm, I really think that he's gonna put Roberts in real serious danger here, because as I said earlier, we know what Roberts can do. He knows every trick in the book. But I'll tell you what, you eliminate the use of that left arm and he's gonna be at a tremendous disadvantage.
Rhodes continues to pound away in that hammerlock position, elbows and knees, high impact moves. And Roberts telling the referee no. Referee Randy Anderson asking Jake the Snake if he wants to submit, and Jake the Snake said no.
I tell you, Jim, this Dustin Rhodes, he really impresses me. This is a young man who's really, he's got great maturity for the short time, really, that he's been in the ring. And he's always, he shows you an awful lot in that ring. You can see that he was coached and coached well. No doubt he's had a lot of coaching for a lot of years because he's very sharp in that ring.
Good pinning predicament here, near fall situation. Jake the Snake able to get that one shoulder up. Fans, don't forget that tonight WCW will be in Jacksonville, Florida. Big event, 8 o'clock tonight in the Coliseum. Tomorrow night in Charleston, South Carolina at the Citadel. And this Tuesday night, a phenomenal card back in Columbus, Georgia at the Municipal Auditorium. More on those events in this program. Rhodes and Roberts back up to a vertical base, and it's Rhodes again continuing to put pressure on that arm. And when Jake the Snake is in this position, Bruno, it's going to be very, very hard for him to execute his favorite move, the DDT.
Absolutely, certainly will be. But I'll tell you what, for how long they've been in that ring now, which has been about, 3-4 minutes, I guess you'd have to say, it's been all Dustin Rhodes. I mean, he really has had things under control, had things going his way. He's been working on that arm, and he has not let go. And a very, very wise, good strategy in that ring.
Everyone is anxiously awaiting the spin the wheel, make the deal matchup on Sunday, October 25th. That'll be an 8 p.m. Eastern time start on pay-per-view. Encourage you to call your local cable company. We'll have more information on that. And Bruno, we're happy to say that you'll be a co-host of that broadcast with Tony Schiavone, and I know you're looking forward to get back in Philadelphia.
I can tell you how thrilled I am. Boy, Philadelphia was a great city for me. Jim wrestled there many, many years. Some of the greatest fans in the world are in Philadelphia, and I know that they'll all be there for this great event.
Jake Roberts reaching for that bag, and we know what is in that bag. We have not seen the Snake but one time, and that was just a glimpse of it back on August the 2nd. And he has kept it bagged, thank goodness.
But I'm impressed with Dustin Rhodes. Look at, he's working on that arm. And I mean, he just has not let go. And I don't know how Jake can possibly get the full use of that arm again throughout this bout, because he's been pounding and pounding on it now from the very beginning of this match.
Roberts again in the ropes. That causes the break. He got a clean one from Dustin Rhodes. But Roberts is having a lot of problems with his arm right there.
What Dustin's got to be careful of, Jim, he can't allow now Roberts, because like you said, Roberts knows every trick in the book, and he'll know how to get out of trouble to try to, you know, get that arm restored a little bit. But good, he's staying on it, and he won't allow him to.
More high impact blows using the forearm and the elbow. Jake the Snake, Roberts' face tells the story here. Jake the Snake in obvious pain. This game plan that Dustin Rhodes is utilizing is very simplistic, but very, very effective.
Well, Jim, let me ask you, are you a little surprised so far the way this match is going? Did you expect that Dustin could take charge from so very beginning of the match and still maintain the charge as he is up to now?
Well, I am somewhat surprised, Bruno, quite frankly. I thought that the experienced veteran Jake the Snake would dictate the pace more in this contest, but it's been young Dustin Rhodes. But he got thumbed in the eye right there, and he's temporarily blinded. Jake tried to slam him, couldn't get him up with that hurt arm. Dustin got the slam and back on the arm. Look at this kid go from Austin, Texas. It was a few weeks ago, Bruno, he was out here and said he felt like that he was ready to wrestle for the United States title. He also talked about that he and Barry Windham, two great second generation athletes, thought that they were at a level that they could compete for the world tag titles as well.
Well, they're both very big, young, very aggressive, very talented. Who knows how far a team like that could go?
Roberts apparently has twisted his knee. And he's writhing in pain here on the canvas. This has not been a good outing for Jake the Snake Roberts thus far. Dustin Rhodes trying to regain the advantage and reestablish his momentum. But Roberts may not be able to continue here.
But Dustin's concerned, because all this time that he's away from Roberts, is going to give Roberts a chance to recoup in that arm a little bit, and he doesn't want that. So we'll have to see if the leg is a serious injury or is it a... See, like you said early, that Roberts knows every dirty trick in the book, and that's what he was doing here.
That was pure subterfuge by Jake the Snake Roberts, and Jake the Snake tosses the kid outside, right out here on the concrete. Jake the Snake Roberts.
Playing a little possum there with that leg.
Mind game, and Jake the Snake drives the knee right into the face of Dustin Rhodes, and he's showing everybody now that his leg was just fine all along, that he has outsmarted, in his estimation, this youngster.
But you know what, though, in a sense, it wasn't Dustin who got outsmarted. It was the referee who believed in the injury, and he was there keeping Dustin back while Jake was by the ropes. But while Jake was doing all along, his little strategy there, and then taking advantage. And right now, Dustin is on a receiving end. And it's a shame because he had really had things under control.
Going to be a gut check here now for the Natural. And Roberts drives that elbow right in the, almost in the throat, perhaps in the throat. Fans, as we promised you also in this broadcast, the Vice President of Wrestling Operations for WCW, Cowboy Bill Watts, will address all of us regarding the light heavyweight tournament and the off-the-top rope rule. We'll hear Bill's announcement later in this program. Roberts really now opening up offensively and challenging this young man. This is, quite frankly, Bruno, how I thought the match would start, with Roberts dictating the pace. And that's exactly now what he's doing after sustaining a great deal of punishment to his arm.
Well, indeed. But like I said, by really pretending that he had a leg injury, he used the referee to his advantage to keep Dustin away and then to throw the cheap shot. And of course, now he's had the upper hand ever since. But I'm not counting Dustin out. This is a young man who can take a lot, and he can come back.
Jake the Snake now, the methodical and evil individual who says that the 12 matches on the wheel are all to his liking, all to his advantage. But I'll tell you something, he and Sting are gonna meet long before October 25th. And I know Sting's got a major score to settle with a man from Stone Mountain, Georgia. And that big event coming up, perhaps fans in an arena near you. Roberts double thrust right to the throat again. And Dustin Rhodes in big, big trouble here.
You know, Jim, he's been concentrating on the throat. When he had him by the apron there, he gave him three different times. He gave him an elbow right to the throat. And, of course, when you're taking those kind of shots, they will take a toll on you. So I hope that Dustin can find a way himself to keep Roberts off long enough to get out of the present situation.
Roberts with that sleeper now. He's restricted the kid's breathing by those blows to the throat, and now he's restricting it somewhat even more by cutting the flow of blood to the brain, and this sleeper now comes back into a reverse chin lock. Jake the Snake working on the head. We know he loves to use the DDT. He caught him with a clothesline. High impact move by Jake the Snake Roberts. And now he's doing some taunting here. Jake the Snake obviously feels that he has everything in control right now.
He's been pretty cocky. He's been pretty cocky, and Dustin isn't looking too good right now. However, I don't know if I'm ready to count this young man out yet.
Jake the Snake signaling that it's time for the vaunted DDT, and that is his calling card. That is his favorite offensive maneuver.
That he does not want to get caught in, because if he does, that usually means it. Beautiful.
Good counter move by Dustin Rhodes. He countered the DDT back into the wrist lock and then a short clothesline. Great counter wrestling by the youngster from Austin, Texas, Dustin Rhodes. But Jake the Snake is relentless, right back on the attack. Irish whip to the far side, and Dustin got the knee up. Dustin Rhodes got the knee up and catches him with that clothesline. Lateral press, he may have him, and he got two. Dustin Rhodes now scoops up Jake the Snake, slams him with authority. He's got him up again, and another slam. Dustin Rhodes has taken back over offensively. Tremendous elbow. Roberts reeling in the corner. Irish whip far side. Dustin's got him in the bulldog. He got him in the bulldog. But Jake the Snake is in the ropes. Dustin thinks he's got it. Jake the Snake had a foot in the ropes, and Dustin Rhodes unaware of it. He got him in the DDT. He got him in the DDT. On top, hooks the leg, and Jake the Snake has won it.
The Snake Roberts!
Jake was in the ropes, and here's the reaction right here. It was the bulldog of the DDT, Bruno.
And that's a shame, because Dustin Rhodes really was doing great, and this was really, in a sense, the cheap shot, because he thought he had the match won, he thought it was all over, and then, boom, he gets Pearl Harbored like that.
And so we come back, we'll hear from Cowboy Bill Watts. That is next on WCW Saturday Night. Welcome back, everyone, to WCW Saturday Night. Jim Ross and Bruno Sammartino back with you. Bruno, I want your comments on what we're about to hear, but first, let's go to this pre-recorded announcement. Cowboy Bill Watts made a statement earlier this week regarding the light heavyweight tournament and also the off-the-top rope rule. Let's go to Bill Watts.
We have two very important announcements tonight. Last week, we had talked about the world's light heavyweight title because we had to strip Brad Armstrong since he was injured and unable to defend it for over 30 days. We talked about a tournament. Because of the contractual commitments, the logistics of contacting the top light heavyweight athletes all over the world, we're going to have that sometime after the first of the year. However, the fans made such a strong statement about my top rope rule that we're still going to address that, because I believe that when the fans make a statement, we got to look at it seriously. The top rope rule, as of today, is rescinded completely in World Championship Wrestling. There is one situation where you can have a flagrant violation which will call for an automatic disqualification. And that's when, if you come off the top rope and your man is laying prone on the mat and you drive your knee into his head or his throat, it's a flagrant violation. We got six or eight examples that we'll show you, so you'll see what we mean right now. In this first example, there you see Rick Steiner climbing to the top, bulldogging Dallas Page off the top rope. That is now legal. In this example, in just a moment, you're going to see Ricky Steamboat, the Dragon, fly off the top rope in one of his high-risk spectacular moves with a cross-body block on the Masked Man. That is legal from now on. This is a more controversial example. Jushin Liger, one of the most exciting light heavyweights in the world. He comes off the top onto a man outside the ring. Again, that's legal as long as he beats the count back into the ring. Another very controversial situation with Ricky Morton, because it involves the knee and the man ends up prone on the mat. However, since Ricky Morton starts the maneuver here on the top, even though it's with the knee, the man wasn't lying prone on the mat when he came off on him. That is legal. In this example, Bobby Eaton, this will be a flagrant violation because he drives the knee into the throat and head area of Rick Steiner. That's a flagrant violation and he would be disqualified. In this example with the U.S. champion Rick Rude against the dynamite young Japanese superstar Sasaki, this would be illegal. This will be a flagrant violation under WCW rules because Rick comes off the top rope and drives the knee into the head and throat area. In this example again, Jushin Liger, his exciting high-risk maneuver. This is legal because even though the man's laying prone, he doesn't drive the knee into him. It's a crossbody block for the pin. Here's an example that the intent of the rule was designed for, to stop potential injury. Because when you got a guy the size of Big Van Vader, over 428 pounds coming off the top rope on people, somebody could actually be fatally injured. This was no longer illegal. This is a splash. He doesn't hit him with a knee. He drops that massive weight on their heads, but it's a splash. That's not a flagrant violation. It's not illegal from this point on.
All right, Bruno, so the light heavyweight tournament will be taking place in 93, but the off-the-top rope rule, the intent of the rule to not allow an athlete to come off the top rope and drive his head into a helpless opponent. What do you think of that rule?
I really think it's a great rule, Jim, because when a guy is hurt and he's out of it and somebody coming off the top rope could do extremely, could be an ending, you know, career ending. On the other hand, now, as it is with the new rule, I think that the guy on the mat, sometimes he can have an advantage because if he's quick, if he's clever, this guy coming off the rope, he could be at a disadvantage. So I think it's a very good rule.
That's why we call them high-risk maneuvers, ladies and gentlemen. We'll talk more about the off-the-top rope rule, but right now let's go back up to Rhubarb Jones.
Ladies and gentlemen, introducing first, with a combined weight of 540 pounds from Nagoya, Japan, they are the Unified World Tag Team Champions, Steve Williams. And introducing their opponents already in the ring with a combined weight of 443 pounds, Larry Santo and Chris Sullivan.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, the number one rated tag team in the world today, the Unified World Tag Team Champions, the WCW World Heavyweight Tag Team Champions, and the NWA Tag Champions, Williams and Gordy. And as a matter of fact, ladies and gentlemen, look at Gordy. He is on the borderline of being bizarre, no doubt about it. But Williams and Gordy will defend the World Tag Titles right here next week on TV on WCW Saturday Night. We'll talk to them about that a little bit later in this broadcast. We do not know who their opponents will be as of yet, as Terry Gordy starts out with Chris Sullivan in this tag team event. Well, Bruno, I know you like basic, fundamentally sound wrestling, and this team, even though they're not the most popular duo in WCW, they're as proficient in pure wrestling skills as just about anybody you'll see.
I'll tell you, Jim, they can be rough, they can bend the rules, but there's no question as far as the talent and the ability these two have. These two are two of the toughest individuals in professional wrestling today. As a team, I'll tell you, they'll be very, very hard to beat. I mean, look at Williams and his past record, not only as a pro, but as an amateur. I mean, these two guys are awesome, and what a big hit they are in Japan.
They're very, very dominant in the Japanese competition. Gordy, who had his first professional match at 14, we understand. I know that's hard to believe, but that's a story that we get. Dr. SD, Williams and Gordy, they make the tag. Double shoulder block. Williams, a four-time wrestling All-American at the University of Oklahoma. Well documented, big number 76, played in four bowl games. Started 3 years for the Oklahoma Sooners football team. Great fireman carry takeover.
These two, they'll give you everything in that ring. They'll give you great wrestling maneuvers. They'll give you some rough maneuvers as well. But I'll tell you what, no matter who they're in that ring with, these two guys, I don't think of it. There is not one team in the world of wrestling that you can say that Gordy and Steve Williams could not go against and do well.
Irish whip in. Dr. Death follows Santo in. Well, I don't know who their opponent's going to be next week. Some great teams in WCW, the Steiner brothers. Arn Anderson and Beautiful Bobby. Good shoulder block by Dr. Death. Windham and Rhodes, we mentioned their names. Tag made, here comes Terry Gordy in. And they are dominating this contest. Short clothesline, Santo tried to block it, but to no avail. Follows him back in. Man, they just maul you. They just completely dominate physically their opponents.
They are rough in every sense of the word. Like, look at this drive that Williams put on this young man. I mean, he really, boom. What's this, a power slam?
He's got him up. He likes that Oklahoma Stampede.
One, two, and now comes what, the power slam? Yes.
He's got the leg hook, and this one is emphatically over.
Not much competition there, Jim.
But they'll get plenty of competition right here next Saturday night, 6:05 Eastern Time. 2 big hours on TBS. Williams and Gordy will defend the World Tag Titles. We'll talk to them about that later in the program, Bruno, as we take another look. Look at the power of Dr. Death.
And now comes, watch, one buckle. But look at the force, the power behind it. Boom. Look at this. Now, not enough. He comes back on the cross ring. And again, and look at, again, the force. And now comes this mighty power slam. And you know that's it. That's curtains.
Fans, as we said earlier today, Cactus Jack and Ron Simmons along the Barbarian had a real close call. We'll show you what happened before we went on the air. We'll have it for you right after this timeout. WCW Saturday Night, Jim Ross and Bruno Sammartino back with you. Earlier today, ladies and gentlemen, Tony Schiavone was talking to Cactus Jack and the Barbarian from one of the cable systems for Halloween Havoc. Ron Simmons walked in, and Bruno, we had some very unscheduled fireworks.
Indeed, there was plenty of fireworks, which is just going to tell you what's going to be at the Halloween Havoc. You're going to have Simmons and the Barbarian. Now, the Barbarian's a big, powerful man, and Simmons is a champ. This is going to be a match that, folks, you cannot afford to miss.
Fans, here's what happened right before we went on the air today.
So it's Halloween Havoc, available on Salmon's Cablevision. Fans, make sure to call your local cable system to order Halloween Havoc, Sunday, October 25th, 8 o'clock Eastern Time, only on pay-per-view. world title. Ron Simmons will defend against the Barbarian, along with Cactus Jack.
I want all you cable systems to understand that you right now are looking at the same thing that I am. The next heavyweight champion of the world. So Ron Simmons,
you couldn't get the job done. And look, I don't know what you call yourself, a manager or trainer. That doesn't matter to me. But I do know this. Tonight, Barry Windham and myself signed a contract to wrestle Butch Reed and the Barbarian. And from what I hear, Butch Reed is not even here. But listen, you're not getting off that light because you're going to find a partner for him. You've been bragging about how big and bad the Barbarian is. Hey, tonight, we're going to find out. And you find somebody for him, and let's get it on.
So the matchup scheduled later today, Ron Simmons and Barry Windham to take on Hacksaw Butch Reed and the Barbarian. We have heard that Butch Reed has not arrived in the arena yet. Obviously, Ron Simmons wants this match to take place.
You better believe it. I don't know who's going to replace Butch Reed because I understand he's tied up in travel or whatever, but somebody's going to be in there because Simmons wants to be in that ring.
Fans, let's go back up to Rhubarb Jones.
Ladies and gentlemen, making his way into the ring area at 232 pounds from Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania, here comes Shane Douglas! And introducing his opponent at 252 pounds from Seattle, Washington, this is John Peterson.
All right, ladies and gentlemen. Before this one gets underway, don't forget action this Thursday night in Altoona, Pennsylvania. This Friday night in Washington, D.C. at the D.C. Armory. And don't forget, coming up in our second hour, Simmons and Barry Windham against Hacksaw Butch Reed and the Barbarian. And again, we'll keep you informed if Butch Reed arrives. If not, as Bruno said, Ron Simmons wants that tag match. Go Cactus Jack to find a partner. Young Shane Douglas, who in the last couple of weeks has looked extremely impressive here, Bruno. I know he's from your hometown.
He's from my neck of the woods, and I've known Shane Douglas now for a number of years, a few years, and this is really a kid with an awful lot of talent. He's a ball of fire in that ring. He's a kid who really loves professional wrestling, and he wants to... Oh, nice drop toe hold, though, by Peterson here. But there again, the quickness of Shane. Yeah, he got out of it. He spun around, and beautiful hammer lock.
Shane, very fundamentally sound. Young man has a very high aspirations. He's a very likable young guy, and he's really been working hard to perfect the belly-to-belly suplex.
Oh, he does that wonderfully. I'll tell you, he used to come to a school that a friend of mine had there. I don't know if you remember the other wrestler named Dominic DiNucci.
Of course, yes.
And this kid, he was there all the time. I mean, he trained like you knew that he was really hungry to become a professional wrestler, to be the very best that he could possibly be. And I'll tell you, when he's in that ring, you can see the excitement. He really loves what he's doing. And this kid's no stopping game. He's going to go all the way.
Next week, Tony Schiavone will be here for a up-close and personal look at Shane Douglas. And while we're talking about up close and personal, Tony also had the opportunity earlier today to talk to Bruno Sammartino, and you'll hear that conversation a little bit later in the broadcast as Douglas has a side headlock applied to John Peterson. Shane is a young man that can generate offense through the air, but he's also a very sound mat wrestler, as we have seen in this last several contests. But Peterson here trying to take a shortcut, not a clean break, trying to gain any advantage he can.
On the mat, he knows all the holds, and he can execute them with speed, with great precision, and a whole bit. But aerially, he's a flyer. He can drop kick, fly head, sit. And here comes a beautiful vertical suplex. Boom.
This kid is young and has so much enthusiasm in his very early 20s. Young bachelor, by the way. I'll throw that in, Bruno.
Yes.
Oh, there he got it. There he got it. The belly-to-belly right at just that quick.
The winner of the match,
don't forget this Thursday night in Altoona, Pennsylvania.
No man.
This Friday night in Washington, D.C. Still to come, our Halloween Havoc Control Center. As we take another look, Bruno, what a great suplex.
Look at this. Belly to belly, boom, right up. Executed perfectly, boom. Down goes Peterson, and that's the pin. Very, very nice.
Still to come, Brad Armstrong, Beautiful Bobby. Special feature on Kintsuki Sasaki. And when we come back, it's our Halloween Havoc Control Center. That's next on TBS. a little bit later in the broadcast. Fans, don't forget to call the wrestling hotline. We've got big news about Halloween Havoc and some high-level meetings at WCW this week regarding the Spin the Wheel, Make the Deal match. That's on the wrestling. Rhubarb.
Ladies and gentlemen, making his way into the ring area, 234 pounds from Marietta, Georgia, here comes Brad Armstrong!
Brad Armstrong, the former WCW World's Light Heavyweight Champion, who will have to wait until 1993 to compete in that tournament, as we heard earlier from Cowboy Bill Watts. And there is absolutely no doubt that Brad is looking forward at any time, any place, anywhere, a one-on-one contest with Flying Brian Pillman. Beautiful Bobby, one of the greats in the sport. He and Armstrong, so technically sound. You won't find any two guys any more technically sound than these two. Side headlock by Beautiful Bobby. Both men, very, very quick. They've refined the art of wrestling, I can tell you that. Neither will make many mistakes. Armstrong with the clean break. Had Eaton back on the ropes. Fans, remember, still to come. Ron Simmons and Barry Windham. Simmons was very, very adamant, as you heard, to take on the Barbarian. And Hacksaw Butch Reed, as of yet, Reed has not arrived at center stage here. Beautiful Bobby taking Armstrong face first into the top turnbuckle. Eaton, who's got that great right hand. Irish whips him in. Oh, he countered that hip lock, attempted hip lock. Fast-paced action here on WCW Saturday Night. And Armstrong takes Eaton up and over, going the aerial route here. Great flying head scissors by the youngster from Marietta, Georgia. Man, what a sad state of affairs it was when he was stripped of the title due to his knee injury. WCW did give him an extra couple of weeks, but here on the biggest night of his life, his dad was here, the 20th anniversary. As a matter of fact, ladies and gentlemen, I'm being joined by a man that was very close to that situation on the Clash of the Champions. The former light heavyweight champion, Brian Pillman, is here. And Brian, I guess thanks for dropping by. It's rather unexpected.
Well, what else can I do, Ross? Here we sit amidst a big group of losers cheering on another loser, another coward who keeps dodging me in the back. I can't even get a match with the guy. I've insulted him, publicly humiliated him on national TV two or three times now. What's it going to take to get a match with the guy, Ross?
Well, I think you just need to go to the promoters. I'm sure the fans would love to see it, and promoters around the country would like to sign that one as Beautiful Bobby gets the right hand in there. You heard the announcement from Cowboy Bill Watts early in the program. The light heavyweight tournament will take place in 93, but you've got a meeting obviously somewhere very close with Brad Armstrong. Great right hand by Beautiful Bobby.
That was a beautiful right hand, you're right, Ross, but I don't know if I'm gonna get a chance to go against Brad Armstrong.
Beautiful Bobby climbing up top now. This is a legal maneuver. And Greg, he countered that superplex. Beautiful Bobby then comes off. Two high-risk moves that were countered by Eaton and Armstrong. I have a hard time, Brian, quite frankly, understanding why you would have such a hard time getting Armstrong to sign a contract. I talked to him just a couple of times this week, and you're all he's talked about.
Well, once again, I'm all he seems to talk about, yet he doesn't have the guts or the courage to sign for a match. Once again, I'm here tonight. He's out in the ring with taking on Bobby Eaton. He had a full-fledged opportunity to step inside the squared circle with Flying Brian. He failed to do so. The record speaks for itself.
So you would like to have this contest on this broadcast, which I think would be a great idea. And I don't think you're going to have a hard time getting Armstrong to agree to terms.
Well, the sooner the better.
Armstrong working on the arm of Beautiful Bobby. The arm barred there. Well, I tell you something, I was as surprised as anybody, and I've known you since the first day you came to WCW. When you slapped him in the face on live primetime television, I was just, probably the only person any more shocked than me was Brad Armstrong. And I still can't understand what provoked you to do that.
Well, Jim, I think I've languish in mediocrity long enough, and it was time to cut the ball and chain off my leg, and that's just what I did, and that's just the first step in a long line of moves and maneuvers that I will utilize to get where I belong, and that's to the top of the world of professional wrestling.
Don't you feel badly that you've turned your back on all the fans that have supported you for so long? And I mean, a lot of kids really looked up to you.
Well, these same fans are the very people that held me back. The bottom line is, winning isn't everything. It's the only thing, and I intend to do whatever it takes to win at all costs, JR.
Well, it's just the attitude that you have right now is just, I'm having a hard time putting it into words how I feel, because I felt like I knew you, but what a great move there in the ring. Armstrong taking a chance there up on the shoulders, as you can see. And oh, he missed there and went over the top rope, but landed on the apron. Beautiful Bobby gets taken down with a great deal of authority there. Armstrong's got a lot of fight in him, as does Eaton. Lateral press got one out of it.
You know, you find it hard to sit here and agree with some of my tactics lately. I find it hard to come out here and listen to you telling me what a great athlete, telling the fans out there in TV land what tremendous athleticism and moves Brett Armstrong has, when deep down inside in your gut, I know you agree with me that he's a total coward.
I don't agree with that whatsoever, Brian. I think he is a great athlete. I think you're a great athlete. And you guys need to settle your differences in the ring. Great backbreaker there by Beautiful Bobby. What a counter move. Beautiful Bobby with a big time move there. He got the backbreaker. It was perfectly executed. Armstrong in a great deal of trouble being turned over.
That's beautiful. I love to see Armstrong writhing in pain, much like what I intend to do to him if I can get my hands on him.
Beautiful Bobby with a tremendous slam. Armstrong bounced right off the canvas. Near a fall there. Now Beautiful Bobby with that waist scissors.
I'm wondering, Ross, if there's any way you can possibly be a mediator somehow, go to the Board of Governors, try, you know, do whatever you can. Use your stroke, get the match signed. I think the people deserve to see it, and I think even Armstrong's family, his parents, need to know once and for all, without eliminate that last shred of doubt they have, that their son's a total gutless coward.
So you're saying that you have an open contract next week, you'd be willing to have the match right here on TV next Saturday?
Absolutely.
Well, I think we could certainly get the ball rolling on that one. That's the promoters make the matches, but we can certainly suggest a couple of things. Armstrong trying to fight out of the pressure now that Eaton is applying on that waist scissors. Armstrong using his upper body strength now. And Beautiful Bobby got the right hand in. Eaton with the advantage. Outstanding contest as Armstrong came up with a fist of his own. To repay Beautiful Bobby. Slapping a guy on TV. I mean, that's not your style. You're a tough guy. I mean, play the National Football League. Slapping a guy in the face. It was so insulting humiliating.
That's right, Ross.
Lateral
played
press
the National
there.
Football League. Been a world champion. I don't think too many other guys can say that.
Lateral press, great drop kick. Well, you're right about that. Well, we're not talking about your athleticism. We're talking about attitude here. That's, again, I can't figure it out. And what a clothesline. That's easy to figure out. What a high impact move. He's going to have it right here. And Armstrong has a foot in the ropes.
I think Armstrong's having a tough time figuring out where he's at right now.
Irish whips reversed. And Beautiful Bobby got the neck breaker in. Armstrong perhaps got the head down a little early, set a little early.
Looks like Armstrong's going to be counting the lights once again.
Remember, off the top rope is legal unless you use that knee as a battering ram on your opponent's throat or head. Going for the Alabama Jam, and he missed it. And Armstrong up very quickly, side rushing leg sweep. He's got the left hook, and he's going to hold it.
Well, isn't that nice? Brad got himself a win.
Brad Armstrong!
So you'll be here next week. You'll be willing.
Well, I wonder if that cheap victory is enough to give him a little false security and take on Flying Brian next week right here on this broadcast.
All right, Brian, well, thanks for dropping by, and we'll See what we can do here on getting that match signed. There you see the miss, the Alabama jam. And Armstrong with a great counter move. The side Russian leg sweep. What a matchup it would be. A real grudge match. Can we get it signed for next Saturday? Armstrong and Pillman will keep you apprised of that in the hour. And when we come back, Bruno will be back and we'll take a look at Kensuke Sasaki next. We're back with Bruno Sammartino, ladies and gentlemen, here on WCW Saturday Night. And Bruno, you've had a great deal of international experience. How do you describe the typical Japanese wrestler?
Jim, I have tremendous respect for the Japanese wrestlers. You know, these guys, they all have great amateur records, backgrounds. They go through like almost like a minor league system, like in baseball. They go through like AA, AAA. And when they come to the pros, believe me, these guys are pros in every sense of the word. They are truly great wrestlers.
Forward to seeing Kensuke Sasaki compete here in WCW. And fans, when we come back, I'll talk to Jake the Snake Roberts. That's next on WCW Saturday Night. Well, ladies and gentlemen, to say I'm uncomfortable would be a gross understatement here, looking at a cobra snake. Jake Roberts, you heard earlier, you were in the situation involving Ron Simmons. He and Barry want to wrestle Hacksaw Butch Reed and the Barbarian. Butch Reed has yet to arrive. What is the status of that situation?
Well, let's get to first things first. The first thing in hand is Halloween Havoc. And believe me, Sting, spin the wheel, make a deal. Your time will be up very shortly. Trust me, because anytime you play with a snake, sooner or later you will be bitten. Now, that's the humane thing to do. If someone is injured, you put them out of their misery. Now, as for you, Ron Simmons, one career win does not make a career, brother. You gotta have more than one. You're worried about nobody being out here with a Barbarian. Well, Cactus Jack, the good bird dog that he is, he tells me that you want it real bad. Well, believe me, and trust me when I tell you this, Barbarian will not be alone. No, he will not stand alone. He will have that partner that he needs, someone he can trust. Because I'll never, and you can tell by my blood-stained hands, I never leave a man alone.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, let's go up to Rhubarb Jones.
Ladies and gentlemen, introducing first at 120 kilograms, formerly of Lithuania, now proudly making his home in the USA, here comes Nikita Koloff! His opponent at 302 pounds from Las Vegas, Nevada, Vinny Vegas.
Big Vinny Vegas, almost 7 feet tall, to take on the master of the sickle, Nikita Koloff, the man who still has his eyes set on the United States Heavyweight Championship. But I tell you, Bruno, I don't like snakes. I'm just gonna tell you right now, I don't like to be around them. They're good shoes, they make good footwear, belts.
I don't like them either, Jeff.
And a cobra that's got a big old flat head looking at you. Jake Roberts is a sick human being. And as far as I'm concerned, that snake has no place out here. I hope it never comes back. Man, what a situation. And he said the Barbarian will not be alone. And that big tag team matchup that is yet to come in this broadcast. Koloff.
Well, that may be an indication if the Butch Reed doesn't make it, maybe he's volunteering to take his place, huh? Although you never know with Jake Roberts, but it's a possibility, don't you think?
Yes, indeed. Koloff getting added momentum from the ropes. A good hard shoulder block, reached back for the leg, and Vegas able to kick out. Vegas has got a distinct leverage advantage in this contest, as he is just about 7 feet tall, over 300 pounds.
For his height of, as you say, almost 7 feet tall and 302, 305 pounds, he really is a good-looking athlete. I mean, he looks really a well-conditioned athlete. But Nikita Koloff, of course, he's the veteran. This is a guy who who knows all the tricks in that ring as well. And right now he's got this arm bar, and let's see where he goes with it.
Fans, don't forget that the current edition of WCW Magazine on sale at newsstands nationwide. It is the finest wrestling publication in the world today. Hope you'll check it out as Koloff reverses the wrist lock back into a hammerlock. Also, want to remind you that we'll be back here at Center Stage on Monday, October 5th. More on that in the program. Irish whip, far side. Koloff missed that, avoided the clothesline.
I'll tell you, Jim, so far we've seen some great matches. It's really exciting to see such great, great athletes in there. They really, really, we've seen some just super, super matches.
Gut wrench, suplex, lateral press, and Koloff able to kick out. Big Benny Vegas looking very impressive here in this contest. Irish whipping Koloff in, and Nikita caught the big man coming to the corner. Koloff has got a big edge and experience here.
Vegas is big and he's very strong, but so far Nikita seems to be a little bit quicker. Seems like he's got the edge on speed, and that's very important.
Koloff just taking him down, manhandling big Vinny Vegas down, but he couldn't hold him there.
I don't think a big fella like that is going to beat him just with a short blow like, whoa.
Uncharacteristic for Koloff to use a drop kick, and he tried one there. And Vegas avoided it, dropped the elbow, and Vegas got one. As we said, Nikita Koloff still in intense training for a match with Ravishing Rick Rude and the U.S. title, and he caught Vegas with a sickle. That's what Rude or anyone else has to avoid. It's over.
The winner of the match, Nikita Koloff.
So Koloff still has his sights set on wearing the United States heavyweight title around his waist. Fans, again, don't forget, we're back at Center Stage on Monday, October 5th, and in Gainesville, Georgia, Tuesday, October the 6th, Bruno.
Look at this, Jim. Now, I mean, this Nikita, he really catching with that sickle. Look at that. I mean, he really put his weight behind it, and Vinny Vegas went down, and he went down for the count.
Fans, when we come back, you'll hear a conversation held earlier today with Tony Schiavone and the living legend, Bruno Sammartino. It's next on WCW Saturday Night.
Join the exclusive WCW fan club. As a member, you'll receive a membership card, a koozie to keep your drinks cold, a choice of a fan club t-shirt or fan club cap, a bumper sticker, and 10% discount on merchandise. To be a member of the fan club, call 404-827-7174.
Welcome back, everyone, to WCW Saturday Night. And now let's hear a conversation held earlier today, up close and personal with Bruno Sammartino. Here's Tony Schiavone.
Okay, fans, Tony Schiavone here. You know, of all the years I've been covering pro wrestling, I guess I have to say this is my biggest moment because I've talked to some of the greats, but for the first time ever, I get a chance to talk to the man. And I'm talking about the one, the only, the real living legend of this sport, bar none. Bruno Sammartino. Bruno, thanks for spending some time with us, and it's great to be able to talk with you. And we saw you return to World Championship Wrestling during Clash of the Champions back on September 2nd. A lot of things have happened in pro wrestling since you retired. Tell us about the change that you've seen in the sport.
Well, you know, Tony, wrestling has been my life. I have such a passion, such a love of professional wrestling, and unfortunately, some other league, they took it to a direction that absolutely bothered me. It hurt me very deeply to see the game that I loved so dearly to become what it was becoming. In recent times, though, thank God, I've seen the WCW and its changes and its direction, and in speaking to people in the organization and other people and plans that they have ahead, and that's really returned the excitement. I am excited again. I'm thrilled again because, like I said, I love this game, and I didn't want to see it butchered as it had been. So now there's tremendous hope that the fans all over the country will get to see what great wrestling is all about, and that's why I'm here.
I know those comments come from the heart because your background in this sport is a storied background. You came over from Europe, from Italy, from poverty, and you rose right to the top of this profession as World Heavyweight Champion. Think back now, and I know this is kind of spur of the moment. Do you have one moment that sticks out more than any in this sport for you?
Well, Tony, as you mentioned, my background, you know, I was there during World War II, and believe me, we're among the lucky to survive. So many people did not. And after we came to this great country, things didn't get very rosy for us, you know, because we really continued in the poverty line. It wasn't bad like it was in Europe, but it was still rough. I trained hard. I really, really did, as so many other athletes have. And when I became a professional wrestler, I did struggle for about 4 or 5 years. But when given a title shot, that was the biggest moment, because when I wrestled Rogers in May 17, 1963, and won the title, that was the biggest thrill in my whole career, because I knew that this meant a change in the life of my family, that now I could become a good provider and help my family into a better life than the one we had known.
This year, Halloween Havoc, we're very excited to announce that you will be a part of Halloween Havoc. You and I will be together as kind of co-host of the event, and I really look forward to this. Of course, Ron Simmons, the World Heavyweight Champion, will defend against the Barbarian. Can you maybe size up that match and give us a prediction?
Well, first of all, as far as that match goes, yeah, I'm excited about that match, first of all, because it's going to be a great one. But, you know, when you say a prediction, you have to look at the Ron Simmons. Identify with a man like Ron Simmons, because this is a man who has struggled. This is a man who nothing was handed to him. You know, it's been a tough, tough life and everything that he's gotten. And here he is. He is the world champion. I mean, this man is going to be like a tiger that night, because it took so much to get here, and he won't want to let go. But on the other hand, he's got a Barbarian, and this is a powerful, really big, powerful man who can wrestle, and he's vicious, and this is his chance. So that there's no question it's going to be a tremendous war, one that people will not soon forget. But if I have to pick one, knowing my own background and knowing what Ron Simmons has gone through, I know what kind of determination he's going to have, and I have to go with Ron Simmons.
And I know you look forward to going back to Philadelphia.
I can't tell you how much, because Philadelphians were so great to me. All the years that I wrestled in Philadelphia, they were so supportive, and I felt like they were family. And so to go back there and to have an opportunity to see all those fans again, it's a real thrill for me.
And it's a thrill for me to be able to work with you. Halloween Havoc only on pay-per-view, and Bruno Sammartino will be a part of it. I'm Tony Schiavone with the real legend in our sport.
The All-New Power Hour is your first choice for Saturday morning wrestling, with new features, updates, and a recap of the week. Join us next Saturday. Missy Hyatt talks about the young stars in WCW. Teddy Long profiles Heavy Metal Van Hammer. Saturday, 9:05 Eastern on TBS. Welcome back, everyone, to WCW Saturday Night. Before we see Van Hammer in action, let's take another look at his world premiere video. We'll be right back.
Ladies and gentlemen, making his way into the ring area from New York City at 270 pounds, here comes Heavy Metal Van Hammer! And introducing his opponent at 220 pounds, from Middleburg, Florida, Kenny McDonald.
I hope you enjoy taking another look at that Heavy Metal Van Hammer video. He's really turned them on here at Center Stage, and we hope that you will turn on AM 750 WSB tomorrow night at 9 o'clock for Wrestling with Jim Ross, Tony Schiavone, and Larry Zbyszko. We'll be there in place of yours truly. Heavy Metal Van Hammer, the big powerhouse, certainly has improved his wrestling skills. Has a great deal of confidence in his own ability. And is certainly not a one-dimensional athlete any longer. When he first got into sport, he really relied on his strength and his power. Kenny McDonald trying to hold on. He's got a death grip, or did have, on the rope. Van Hammer pulls him loose. Irish whips him in and follows him in with a tremendous clothesline, and McDonald has nowhere to go here. He is just about out on his feet now. Still to come, we'll be rejoined by Bruno Sammartino, World's Heavyweight Champion Ron Simmons, and Barry Windham to take on the Barbarian. Hacksaw Butch Reed has yet to arrive. Who will be the Barbarian's partner? That match is still to come. Strong Irish whip into the corner. And Hammer is really manhandling his opponent here. We would like to take this opportunity once again to remind all the great fans in the Columbus, Georgia area to join us this Tuesday night in Columbus, 7 o'clock bell time. And here comes that Hammer Rock suplex. Heavy Metal Van Hammer has been dominant in this contest and wins it easily.
The winner of the match, Heavy Metal Van Hammer.
You know who rocks WCW. And don't forget it.
Heavy Metal Van Hammer certainly dominant in this contest. As we take another look at his high-impact offense. Fans, remember, Halloween Havoc is coming your way exclusively on pay-per-view. Sunday night, October 25th, 8 o'clock Eastern from Philadelphia. Here's more on that, and then I'll be back to talk to the Unified World Tag Team Champions. Ladies and gentlemen, here with the Unified World Tag Team Champions, Dr. Death Steve Williams and Terry Bam Bam Gordy, who will defend the World Tag Team Championship right here next Saturday on WCW Saturday Night. I don't know who your opponent's going to be, gentlemen. I'm sure that you don't either, and probably don't really care.
Hey, that's right. We don't care, Jim. You know, it's like this. We have went out and did the impossible. We have went out and did something that every tag team in the world is dreaming about. We have put two world championship titles together. Now, I'm telling you right now, that's what a lot of teams like the Steiners and people like that are dreaming about doing. Now, let me tell you this. These are our world titles, and we worked hard for them. Now, I think it ought to be up to us who we put these up against, and I think you ought to get some young talent out here. Get some Rhodeses. Get some Watts. Let's see what they can do. We done beat everybody else.
Well, Doc, I know that apparently it doesn't make any difference, but the promoters are going to put some great challengers and some great teams. Anderson and Eaton, Steiner Brothers, Windham and Rhodes, a great team will be here next week to challenge you.
Well, Jim, you know, it's slowly on the top, and everybody's gunning for you. Well, I'll tell you something. It doesn't matter who signs the contract. Me and Terry will take on anyone. You know, TBS talks about equal opportunities. Well, you know, you got some young punks out there who would like to sign the contract. Well, hey, you know, you got Bagwells as my partner named off the list.
So, hey, all we say is sign the contract and get up in the ring.
Well, Doc and Terry may prefer to take on a younger team. We'll see what the promoters think next week. And fans, when we come back, it's that big tag team matchup we were telling you about. Ron Simmons and Barry Windham to take on the Barbarian. Who will his partner be? We'll find out when we come back on TBS.
Ladies and gentlemen, the following contest is scheduled for one fall or TV time remaining. Introducing first, at 299 pounds, from parts unknown, the Barbarian, and from Stone Mountain, Georgia, Jake the Snake Roberts.
Accompanied to the ring by Cactus Jack. Well, there we see the man that will stand beside the Barbarian in this contest, Bruno. Jake the Snake Roberts is here. That cobra is in that bag. I hope it stays there. As we go back up to our ring announcer, Rhubarb Jones.
Ladies and gentlemen, introducing the World Heavyweight Champion at 275 pounds from Warner Robins, Georgia, the All-American Ron Simmons, and his partner, 272 pounds from Sweetwater, Texas, Barry Windham.
Okay, what a matchup this should be right here on TBS. Thank you for being with us here on WCW Saturday Night. I want to remind you that due to the Braves and the Padres, there'll be no main event tomorrow. Braves and the Padres baseball game will occupy our time slot next week, or tomorrow, rather. There you see Cactus Jack, one of the most bizarre competitors I've ever been around. Bruno, this is a match here that this is one of those ones that you feel there's a lot of animosity, a lot of hate, as far as it relates to Ron Simmons and that Barbarian.
There sure is, and what happened, you know, with Cactus Jack and so forth, you could see the fire in Simmons. He was really angry, and I think he was also upset when we found out that Butch Reed might not show up, that this match was not going to take place, and Simmons really wanted it bad. And I think he's very happy. And I think he's happy that Jake Snake took his place. I really do, because I don't think he has much love for Jake the Snake, so I think that this is going to be a tough match. There's no question, because there's a lot of bad feelings here.
This is the second time in this program that Roberts has competed. Remember, when he took on Dustin Rhodes in the very first match of the program, Rhodes worked on that arm. And that's what Barry Windham has gone right back to. Tags in the world's heavyweight champion, Ron Simmons. And Simmons continues to work on that arm as well.
No doubt they saw that match, and they saw the damage that Dustin did. So why not take over and take advantage of that situation? But I'll tell you look at the Barbarian, Jim, and this is a rugged individual. Be interesting to see when he and Simmons first meet head on, huh?
It sure will. And I'll tell you something else. Cactus Jack adds a very unique dimension to the Barbarian as well. That's Barry Windham, a talented young man from Sweetwater, Texas. As I said earlier, when that Dustin Rhodes, Jake Roberts match, Barry and Dustin have really been working hard to study game film and to perfect their tag team wrestling style. They're a great team in their own right, but here with Barry tagging with Ron Simmons, how much better can it get when you can tag with the world's heavyweight champion?
That's true, and I'm impressed right now that Windham is working on Robert's arm. Wisely pushes Windham to the corners, and he tags out. And very wise, because that arm has got to be sore from the previous match with Dustin, and he needs to have it rested.
Barry Windham has had his share of problems with the Barbarian as well. And look at how strong the Barbarian is.
And we're talking about Windham, who weighs, what, 275? I mean, picked him up and just threw him halfway across that ring. This Barbarian's a very powerful man.
Barbarian, a lot of people say, has always had the physical tools to be a world's champion. He just needed leadership, and I guess he's got that, if you can call it that, with Cactus Jack there. Again, we see how strong this man is. And normally, Bruno, Simmons has the advantage when he wrestles in a title match, as a rule, as far as strength is concerned. Well, this big Barbarian, he's not going to have a decided strength advantage.
No, absolutely not. This is going to be, strength-wise, it's going to be close. And in fact, the Barbarian is even bigger of the two. I think he weighs around 300 pounds to Simmons, 270 pounds. But here they are now, face-to-face, nose-to-nose, and let's see who delivers the first blow. Oh, double tackle.
Both men getting some extra momentum, fans. We're about 30 seconds or so away from having to take a break. As is customary here, we will keep our cameras taping. If a decision is rendered during the commercial break, we'll show it to you as soon as we come back. Oh, he caught him! Big Ron Simmons caught him with that clothesline, but the Barbarian's back up! He got right back up, Bruno!
He got right back up, and he came on to Simmons, and he's got him against the corner, just threw a couple of powerful rights, and Simmons looks right now like he's shaking up.
Tremendous clubbing forearm blows, and the Barbarian becoming physically dominant over Ron Simmons here in this particular point in time in the contest. Fans, we've got to take a break. We'll be back. We'll keep our cameras taping, and we'll be back. Don't you go away. The action is hot on TBS. Welcome back, ladies and gentlemen, to WCW Saturday Night. Jim Ross and Bruno Sammartino back with you. What a physical exchange Ron Simmons and the Barbarian are having, and they had it during the commercial break as well. And Bruno, quite frankly, neither man could really gain a physical upper hand in that last offensive flurry.
Absolutely, just went back and forth. And of course, there's always the interference with Jake the Snake when Simmons gets the upper hand. And of course, how about Cactus out there? Gotta be leery of him because, you know, he's capable of doing something, so.
There you see the Barbarian again showing his great strength. Putting Barry Windham up on the top turnbuckle. Barry Windham shows good agility. There's a lariat, caught Barbarian in the chest, but didn't put him down, but the arm drag takedown does. The Barbarian is a load to get off his feet.
You know, Windham, for a big guy that he is, he shows such great speed. I mean, it's very impressive because this is a big, big man. You know, he's, what is he, 6'7", 275 pounds? I mean, he moves like a guy 240 pounds. He's just a great speed.
Fans, don't forget to join us here next Saturday, WCW Saturday Night. Williams and Gordy will defend the World Tag Team titles here next Saturday. We also have been informed that Brett Armstrong will meet Fly-In Brian Pillman here next Saturday as well. Up close and personal with Shane Douglas, and Arn Anderson will be here with us. Bruno, hope you can come back and join us next week as well.
I think I'm looking forward to it, that Pillman Armstrong match. That's really going to be something.
Jake the Snake in, distracting the referee. And Windham set for the ride. And what a power slam. That's reminiscent of a Ron Simmons power slam. And the Barbarian just drives that elbow into Barry Windham. Look how dominant this man is. He has great agility. He is not a plotter. He's a guy that is not methodical, even though he's 300 pounds. And now is he gonna tag Jake? Yes, he does.
I thought after that great power slam and those two big elbow drops, I thought that that might be it. But I'll tell you, that tells something for Barry Windham and what a tough young man he is and what he can absorb and still come back.
Jake the Snake ramming Windham's face into the top turnbuckle. The master of the DDT, who already has a victory in this program using that DDT. You know, knowing that the world's champion will face the Barbarian, we can't take for granted it's going to be Ron Simmons. Simmons has got to meet Ravishing Rick Rude between now and October 25th. He's got to meet Big Van Vader between now and then. And Bruno, as you know, a championships are won and lost in 3 seconds.
Absolutely. When you talk men of that caliber, on any given night, anybody can beat anybody. But right now, Simmons is the champion, so we have to assume Simmons. And if this match, if it will be Simmons and a Barbarian, I still say when you have both of those two in the ring without, you know, the other two right now outside interference, I think that we're going to see one heck of a battle.
Barbarian with a slam, showing his strength here. Referee did not see the tag. He's gonna make Jake the Snake come back in. But in the meantime, the Barbarian with a dynamic backbreaker. Jake the Snake with that cover. And Windham trying to kick out the referee. Nick Patrick's gotta get Ron Simmons out of there. And perhaps that was a break for Barry Windham because Jake the Snake had him wrapped up in the cover. Jake the Snake now choking Windham, trying to rob him of his oxygen, trying to take it all from him. And look at Cactus Jack! Cactus Jack ripping at the face of Barry Windham, and that's what we're talking about. In Philadelphia on Sunday, October 25th, I'm understanding Cactus will be at ringside.
And that creates a big problem for Simmons because with Cactus Jack at ringside, you know that when his man is going to be in trouble, You can't put anything past Cactus Jack. This is a very dangerous and weird individual. Right now, if Barry Windham could only get to Simmons. Simmons is so anxious to get in that ring. I mean, he's really fired up. He wants to get in there and really do something. But unfortunately, Windham has really been taking a pretty good beating. But he is striving, pushing forward Simmons. Maybe he will, maybe he will make the tag. He's getting close there.
Getting very close. Remember, he's a big, tall, lucky individual with long arms. There you see how close they are. Inches away, inches away. Can he make it?
I think he's got it.
He made the tag, but did the referee see it?
Referee didn't see it.
He did make the tag, but the referee did not see it. Roberts, he did his duty there, and then the Barbarian throws Windham over the top rope. That's an automatic disqualification, but the referee is having trouble restraining Ron Simmons. The referee happened to miss both those situations.
Well, that's where Roberts is very clever. He saw that the tag was going to be made, so he did what he could to distract the referee. He succeeded. The tag was made. Unfortunately, it didn't count. And now who's paying the price? Barry Windham.
Oh, what great action we've had here on the program. Again, we hope you'll be back with us again next week. We got more news that we'll be telling you about until midnight tonight on the Wrestling Hotline. Things are really getting hot in WCW.
I'll tell you, Jim, this has been such great wrestling. I hope that all the people who watch this tell their friends about it to tune in, because you're not going to find better wrestling than what we're seeing here.
Windham fighting back with all he's got, nailing the Barbarian. But it's Jake the Snake Roberts who did get the legal tag. Jake the Snake in there, and Jake the Snake taunting Ron Simmons. Simmons has got so much emotion. He's been waiting there. He's watched his partner get hammered by both men. And Cactus Jack now, all three, Cactus Jack, Roberts, and the Barbarian have really assaulted Barry Windham in this contest.
But you know, Jim, I understand Simmons' frustrations, but he's got to be close to his corner, because he cannot miss the opportunity if Windham can work his way towards that corner. Because as long as he's being distracted and moves away from that corner, Windham is getting in deeper and deeper trouble.
Jake the Snake with that powerful short clothesline found its mark on Barry Windham, and Windham really being physically challenged here. How much more of this punishment can the big man from Sweetwater take? He's got it hooked up. I thought he was going for the DDT, but he hesitated momentarily, just one split second, and Barry Windham was able to counter.
He thought that Windham wouldn't have the strength. Windham looked like he was out on his feet, and Windham just scooped him up like a back body drop and took him down. Now, if he can only tag Simmons, that's what he's got to do. Get Simmons, and there he's got it.
He got it. He got the tag. Big Ron Simmons in the bar. Trips him in, caught him in the elbow. Jake the Snake Roberts in. Knee with clothesline. He knocks down the Barbarian. The world's heavyweight champion is on fire here. Look at the high impact moves. Oh, they got him standing here at center stage. The Barbarian, though, the fist right to the ribs. An Irish whip, but it's reversed to the far side. He got him up, and a sidewalk slam. Hooks the leg, and Jake Roberts interrupts the count, and here comes Windham. And the Barbarian nails Windham from behind with that huge arm. Simmons is down from the elbow by Jake the Snake. Simmons comes across and knocks Roberts out on the apron. Ron trying to hold his partner up. The Barbarian, what's he doing? Stomping that foot. And he kicked. Oh, my.
And look what's coming in the ring. Here's Cactus Jack.
What a kick. He kicked Simmons right in the face and put his lights out. And now Cactus Jack and Barbarian both trying to double team the world's heavyweight champion. This big monster, the Barbarian, doesn't want to wait until Halloween Havoc as he goes up top. He's going up top. And a headbutt right to the heart and shoulder. Here comes Dustin Rhodes and Van Hammer. It is chaotic here. Situation, fans from Bruno